Right now, this session is entitled Disciplining Children, and it's on page 49 of your note-taking supplement. Now, the word discipline comes from the word disciple. So many times when people hear the word discipline or think about disciplining their children, the word punishment actually is what they're thinking of. Or it's this anticipation that my children are wrong and I have to punish them. Now, nothing could be further from the truth. As a matter of fact, if we have that mindset, in spite of our sincere intentions of raising our children the right way, we're going to end up with the wrong attitude in the way we approach our children. Because when Scripture says, train up a child in the way he should go, the word training is assuming that you and I have a frame of reference, that we know what it is we're supposed to do with our children, so that when that child is older, we will see the type of character and the type of qualities in their lives. Now, that doesn't guarantee that our children won't do things wrong. Are any of you still doing things wrong? And we're already telling our kids what not to do? Isn't that kind of a paradox? We know every single thing of how to tell them to do everything right, and we're still doing things wrong, and we seem to get upset with them if they do some things wrong. The truth of the matter is, you ought to expect your kids to do things wrong. And you ought to be thrilled that they're doing the things wrong in your home. If they break the window at the local pharmacy, we have a problem. You know, but if they're playing ball and the ball goes through the window of the house, they have a problem, but they have a different kind of problem. And so there needs to be in our heart and mind, and I believe this is the key that had, and I didn't start out with my first child because I didn't have this right frame of reference, but when I finally locked into it, it changed my whole disposition about raising my children. And that is, it has become my goal to be a lifetime friend to my son and my daughters. And it's my wife's goal to be a lifetime girlfriend to my son and daughters. Now, what that did for me anyway is it took out of my mind the attitude, I got to get them raised. I hope I can get them to 17 or 18 or out of high school. And then, then if they made it safe, I did it. Now if they don't do it from now on, I'm not going to have to take the blame for it. And we develop all these kinds of attitudes, and that's not what God has in mind at all. In addition to God wanting us to introduce our children to Christ and to come to a saving knowledge of Christ, there are three objectives that God wants us to accomplish in our children's mind, in their lives. And I believe that there are three frames of references, which we're going to share here, that if we as parents get a handle on these three frames of references, you will be able to field 95% of all the things that happened with your children and know how to deal with them and have the confidence that what you're doing and the way you're doing it's the right way. So the first frame of reference is to be able to define what is the objective or objectives, of which I believe there are three, that God wants me to accomplish in my children's lives as much as this is possible while they're growing up in my home. The first one is he wants me to teach my child how to obey. The second is he wants me to teach my child how to treat other people. Or in other words, I use the word respect. Anytime there is a problem with my children and other people are involved, then the problem is respect or the lack of respect. The third thing is to teach my child responsibilities. In other words, I ask my child to do something, And it's my responsibility to get them to learn how to be responsible. Now, you might sense that all three of these objectives are just the opposite of the inclinations of our children. I didn't teach my child to say, no, I won't. I mean, it just came out so easy, they must have got it from their mother. I didn't teach my child to hit somebody back if they hit them. Or to have a bad attitude toward someone. And I didn't teach my child to come up with all kinds of excuses, like I forgot and I don't want to and I don't feel like it, when you ask them to do things. That is the way we all are prone to function. So when my child does something, I need to ask the question, or doesn't do something, I need to ask the question, is he being disobedient, disrespectful, or irresponsible? For example, my son hits his sister. Now you tell me which is the best form of correction. David hits his sister and hits her hard. Do I spank him? Do I send him to his room? Do I pull them apart and set them in two corners of the room till they cool down and then they can go back and play together? Do I take television away from them? Do I take something else that's important? He can't ride his bike or he can't do something he really would like to do. Out of those situations, which one is the best alternative? Separating them, okay? Now, the answer is none of those. Okay? The answer is none of those. Okay? I didn't say that to trick you. I used to just kind of do whatever seemed to be, you know, the thing to do at the time, usually depending on how I felt. But now let's go back and just ask a real simple question. When he hit his sister, was he being disobedient? No, I wasn't there watching him and he's like this and I said, David, don't you dare. So he wasn't being disobedient. Was he being disrespectful? He's being disrespectful. It involves another person. Now, if the problem is disrespect, the purpose of training is correction. The only time you punish a child is for rebellion. If I told my son to do something and he said to me, stick it in your ear, big boy, I ain't doing it. He is in real big trouble, okay? That is rebellion. If I told him to clean his room up and he wasted the whole day and never got his room cleaned up, is that disobedience, disrespect, or irresponsibility? It's irresponsibility. I gave him a responsibility, and he was better at it than I was in figuring ways not to ever get around to it. And boy, I tell you, as they get older, the reasons get better. To where you're just kind of stop cold. Well, Mom asked me to do something else, or well, Dad, I've got this big test tomorrow, and I can't. I mean, it goes on and on. And then we're prone to say, oh, well, okay, if they didn't do that, well, I understand. And so then I let them go, and they didn't have to be responsible. Now, if my son is disrespectful, the correction is what? How do you make somebody respectful? What does he have to do? Apologize. Now, I'll tell you what, when he's in a bad mindset, it is tougher to get him to apologize than to give him a spanking. You know, what if he's a loner, likes to be alone, you don't think it's too good, maybe it isn't too good, you're not even sure if it's good for kids to be alone in their rooms. I've seen parents do that, I don't think it's good for them to be alone in their rooms. When people with the gift of serving or teachers who love to read, being in their rooms is the greatest thing they could ever do. Let them go to their room, and when you go in the room, you'll actually find out that they're doing something with their time. Now me, if I was in my room, alone, when I love people and I like to be around people and I don't like to be alone, I am up to no good. See? But it's a shame that parents categorize all that and turn around and don't recognize that some people really enjoy being alone. They're not depressed. They're not being bad. They just really appreciate the chance to get alone and do some things or read or write or whatever. And that's normal. But let's say my son likes to be alone, and I'm a parent that thinks that that might not be too good. And so when he's bad, he hits his sister, I send him to his room. You get to your room right now, and I'll tell you when you can come out. Yeah, did he have to be respectful? No. As a matter of fact, the only way he can get to his room is slug his sister. So you have to insist that that child apologize. We were on a trip one time. I had my whole family, and sometimes they would go to seminars with me. But we were, the very first night, Monday night, we were invited to this home for supper. We weren't there more than 5 minutes, and in the living room, I hear these two blood-curdling screams. And you know, when you're teaching a seminar designed for the successful family, you bring them out, and all of a sudden, everything falls apart. And I go into the room, and here is David and Cheryl crying. And I said, "What's the matter?" And David said, "Cheryl hit me." And Cheryl says, "David took my toy." Now, I always have to start figuring this whole thing logically. I have to go back to this one and this one and this one. My wife doesn't. She can tell by the sound of the cry who started it. But I have to start this whole thing over again. And I said, "David, you cannot go and take somebody's toy." And he said, "Well, I said, please." So I go back to Cheryl, and we had this in our family. Anytime you're playing with something of your own, but somebody says, "Please, may I use it?" you have to share it with them. What principle? The one we just covered. What is it? Yielding rights. Doesn't the kid say, "This is mine? This is my toy. It's not your toy." Now, I don't sit there and say, "Honey, this is God's toy, you know." I don't say that. I know that it isn't his, and that the principle I've got to teach my child is to share. That's the practical principle for children. You have to learn to share. And so if they said please, you have to share the toy with them. Now, they now do not become the permanent owner of this toy for the rest of the day. They ask to use it. The other person has to share with it. And then I would put a time limit. Okay, you can play with it for 10 minutes, then you have to give it back to Cheryl. And then I would give Cheryl something else, or I'd say, "Hey, let you and me go play," or something. I would fill in the gap with them. You'd be amazed how many times he doesn't want the toy anymore. He'd rather play with me. "Here, you take the toy, let me play with Dad." No, you play with the toy. And so David had done the right thing. He had said, "Please." So now I go back to Cheryl, and I said, "Cheryl, when somebody says please, you have to share your toys with them." And by the way, our kids don't catch this by one lecture. You go on and you do this year after year after year. But you know what the principle is. And so I said, "What do you say to David for not sharing your toy?" And she said, "I'm sorry, David." Okay, now she wronged him. And she apologized. Now, when somebody apologizes, now what do you need to do? You need to forgive them. And so I turned to David and I said, "Dave, Cheryl said she was sorry for not sharing the toy. Will you forgive her?" And David's crying. And he says, "No." And I said, "David, she's really sorry. Will you please forgive her?" "No." Now, of course, I'm in this home, and I'm getting real nervous because I know they're all just listening to hear what's going on. And I'm getting nervous enough to think, you know what, you are making such a big deal out of this. Why don't you just drop it, leave them alone. They're kids. In no time, they'll go back to playing with each other. Just leave them alone. Except for what? My son was wronged. The person even apologized What is his responsibility? To forgive him. Where do we get the idea as adults that if I don't want to forgive, I don't have to? Depending on the circumstances. I believe it was when our parents said, oh, they're just kids, leave them, go back, leave them alone. They'll get back together. And we carry those little resentments, and they just start building up to where I have this attitude toward my sister or my brother, and I don't like them. And I never learned how to forgive. So now I'm in a situation I never faced before, and this is where we need that equity. I knew David was hurt, and I'm trying to figure out, all right, how can I get him to forgive her? Now, there really was a feeling I wanted to come back. I wanted them to go back to love each other again, right? So and this is what Scripture calls equity. If you read and study Proverbs, you will develop equity in your life. Equity is the ability to deal with a situation you've never faced before. And so I squatted down, I put my arms around the two of them, and I said, you know what I think? Cheryl says, what? David says, what? I said, I think that Cheryl can hug you tighter than you can hug her. Oh, I can, Dad. Oh, no, you can't. And they start hugging. And they start hugging as tight as they can, and they start laughing. And David falls apart. He falls on the floor laughing. Cheryl, you are so funny. I said, David, Cheryl said she's sorry. Will you forgive her? You're forgiven, Cheryl. I said, now what do you say to Cheryl for hitting her? I'm sorry, Cheryl. Cheryl says, you're forgiven, David. Then they go back and play with each other. So they had to be respectful. Now keep in mind that your children don't have any motives for this until they're 9 or 10. So if you say, oh, well, I'll wait until the... Now your motives aren't right. You make the child do what is right anyway. I recall one time I had gotten up from the table, and you know how panicky we mates get when the other one is disciplining and we're not there? We're almost always sure the other one's doing it wrong. What in the world is going on? And we almost always disagree with whatever punishment she chose or he chose. It's either too hard or too lenient. And I'm out in the living room, and I hear Karen getting a spanking. She's about 3 years old. And a couple minutes later, I hear her getting another spanking. And I'm starting to get upset and say, what in the world is going on? And I walk out in the kitchen table, and the story was this, that she and David were sitting there talking, and she got mad, and she hauled off and let him have a broadside right across the face. And he is crying. I mean, he's hurt. And so Carol had said to Karen, I mean, you know, it sort of shocks you, and, Karen, what did you do? I hit David. Will you tell David you're sorry? No. Okay? So now what you do is, and by the way, a child 3 years of age or older can understand this. I'm going to tell you what I want you to do. If you don't do it, we're going to explain it. Then if you don't do it, then there's going to be a punishment. So she says, you tell David you're sorry. She says, no. Now, it started out as what? When she slugged him, what? Disrespect. When she turned to mother and says, no, we've got a second problem. We have rebellion. See? This is how you make the distinction between disobedience. It isn't disobedience when you tell the child to do something like clean his room or hang up the clothes. That's a responsibility. When they don't do that, you deal with that differently. But when they say no, so Carol spanked her and then put her back down on the floor and said, now you tell David you're sorry. And she said, no. That's when I heard the second spanking. And I'm coming out, what in the world? And of course, I was sure that if you just approach these things logically and be patient and do this right, this whole thing would work out really easy. So after the second one, I'm trying to hold my composure that I'm upset with my wife that she spanked the child twice. If she'd have gone about this right, this would not have happened. Honey, let me take care of this. So I backed it up. I said, Karen, what'd you do? I hit David in the face. I says, was that right? No. Was that wrong? Yes. when you hit somebody, do you have to apologize? You see how thorough I am at this? Do you have to apologize? Yes. I said, then you need to apologize? She said, yes. I said, well, then you tell David you're sorry. No. I said, you tell David you're sorry. No. I cannot believe this. I pick her up and I paddle her. Now, I've only paddled my kids. I think the most I paddled any of my children, was maybe four times in their lifetime. And my wife would say, oh, I spanked them quite a few more times, you know. And when I spanked with the stick, you use a neutral object. You don't use your hands. And I always made the first one. I mean, wish it had never come. I mean, it was whew. I mean, it was whew. Because I want my kids to cry real fast. I don't want to, you know, build up this crescendo, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and trying to find that level of where we're going to make them cry. I'm telling you, when the first one's a sizzler, I mean, if you go slow enough on the second one, the tears have already started. That keeps you down to a real short spanking, which I like. And so I think I swatted her about 3 times, and I put her down on the floor. Now, you can always tell when the effect of the spanking is over, because the child goes like this. See? Now, once they do that, the effect of the spanking is over. If they start crying some more, other antics, they're trying to work on you. See? So I said, now you tell David you're sorry. She said, no. I cannot believe this. So I pick her up and I spank her again. And I put her down on the floor. And I said, now you tell David you're sorry. I'm sorry, David. And then I said, now you give David a kiss, you know, and they kissed each other. The next day, Karen is running through the family room and David is laying on the floor just playing and something, and Karen runs and walks on his head. I mean, so her foot comes down on his hair and all, and he lets out the same scream he let out the night before. Ah, Karen! You should have seen this little kid. She turns around in horror. She looks at him. I'm sorry, David. I'm sorry, David. I'm sorry, David. And she reached down and opens her mouth and gives him one of those wet kisses, you know. Four or five years later, Karen, you know, she's the comforter, and she was always the little mother of the neighborhood, and she had a little girlfriend, Amy, that was the same age, 5 years old. Cheryl comes home one day from school, and here's Karen out there giving Amy a spanking because she was a bad girl. And Cheryl says, Karen, what are you doing? You can't go spanking Amy. You're not her mother. I'm telling Mom. So Cheryl comes in and tells Carol. About 3 minutes later, Karen comes flying in the house, and I'm there, and I says, Karen, I said, you cannot go spank Dad. I already went and told Amy I'm sorry. And I won't do it again. See, what'd she know what to do? See? She needed to apologize. I only spanked Karen twice, you know, in her life that I remember. And she remembers both of them. The other one, she was in the bathroom talking to Carol one time, and I don't know what it was about, but Carol just came out of the bathroom. She's correcting her or something. And just as Carol goes out and heads toward the kitchen, and I am walking right up on the toward the bathroom door, and Karen's standing here at the sink like this. And she says, I like, you're stupid, Mom. And just then, you know, Dad comes around the corner, and it's like, I said, what did you say? And so, what was that? Disrespect. And she had to go and apologize to her mom But there was rebellion there too. And that I spanked her for that. Because she's doing that behind. There's just sheer rebellion in her whole spirit. You see, she didn't say it to Carol. And so I spanked her for that. Don't you ever say that about somebody again. And you go and tell Mom you're sorry. And so she went and apologized. Now, you know what? Words like stupid and so forth, you would never hear in my home. The kids never can call somebody stupid. Never can use those types of terms. Now, they have done it. Don't we all? But when they do it, it's disrespectful and you have to apologize. If you give the child a responsibility, where the parent makes such a great mistake is they give the child a responsibility, and then we are all ingenious at coming up with excuses or reasons why we never got around to that to fulfilling that responsibility. I'd venture to say there are some of you men here who promised your wife 2 years ago that you would do something by Friday or Sunday. And, you know, the car broke down. You had all the reasons in the world why it just never quite got done. Now, were you being disobedient or irresponsible? Being irresponsible. And so our children, when you give them responsibilities and they are irresponsible, then they have to assume the responsibility for it. I was speaking in Buffalo years ago, and Mom and Dad had always had trouble agreeing on how to discipline their child. And it was really a problem. And so, but they went home from the seminar that night, and their boy, you know, it was in the winter, and he had gotten an airplane or something like that for Christmas, and he wanted to fly it out of the upstairs window. So unknown to Mom, he goes and he tries to open the storm window, and it's frozen, so he goes and gets a hammer. And you know what happened? He broke the glass. And Mom hears this crash, and she comes upstairs, and she said, I want to tell you, in the past, I would have blistered his bottom. But instead, I thought, oh, wait a minute. Is he being disobedient? No, I never said don't use a hammer to open the screen, the storm window when it's frozen. Is he being disrespectful? No, apologizing to the window will not help. Is he being irresponsible? Yes, he is. And she said, Mark, because you broke the window, you're going to have to get your money and pay for it. That's why I am a firm believer that our children need an allowance until they're able to earn money. It doesn't matter how much it is, and we'll talk about that later today. Because there are going to be things that they do that they break for which they need to be responsible. Dad comes home. Happens to go upstairs, hadn't talked to his wife yet, and sees the broken window and says, what happened? And Mark comes out, and he runs through the same filter, and he says, well, Mark, you're going to have to take your money and pay for the window. He says, I know, Mom already told me I had to. He says, well, come on, let's go. Go get your money. We'll get this out of here, and we'll take it down, and we'll fix it, and the son paid for it. My boy David, Carol got two brand new chairs, light blue. And the kids were making posters on the tile part of our hallway. And David and Cheryl are fooling around, and David decides to take this indelible red ink pen and flip it at her, and he goes like this, she ducks, and it hits the new chair. New pattern, decorated red dots. My wife comes and she sees it, and her response is, David, you're going to have to get those dots off of there. He'd been irresponsible, right? He tried to get them off. He couldn't. She knew it was indelible ink. We called Service Master. $38 to try to get it off, and they still couldn't get it off. But David forked out the $38 to do everything possible for that, and we still have that chair with those little red dots on it. Memories of the kids when they were growing up, right? He's in 11th grade. We live out on a dirt road, and David is backing down the driveway, and it's a dead-end road also. So what does he do? Not look. Backs right into an old beat-up truck coming down the road. And the guy gets out and says, well, son, what's another dent in my truck? But you got a problem there, boy. So David forked out $872 of his own money to pay for it. He just got his license. And I says, well, we can do it one of two ways. I said, if we file this claim on the insurance, my premium is going up, and you will pay the difference of the premium from now on until they reduce that back down, or you can pay out of your money. He went and got his money. Now, I'll talk to you later about how I taught my children how to manage money, because by the time they got out of college or ready to go to college, they had money. It's very exciting. When they started tithing, they started seeing God trust them with more money and so forth. When David was 10, that's when I feel you can start telling the kids, okay, I want you to do this on your own, or at least give them the choice. They'll always choose, I want to do it on my own. They're just learning to function like an adult. And I said, Dave, look, I want you to clean your room. And now, we can do it one of two ways. We can do it like Mom's always done it. She tells you what to do. Next, I want you to work in your closet. Next, I want you to hang up your clothes. You know how moms do that. And he'd been doing it for quite a while. And I said, or you can work this out in your own time schedule. You're a grown-up guy now, and you can think for yourself. So what would you rather do? I'd rather work it out on my own, Dad. He says, okay, here's the deal. You don't go to bed tonight till your room's done. Okay, this is early Saturday morning. I felt so good. I had just done this thing so perfectly. And that boy of mine's got a good head on his shoulder. He's going to think this through, lay out his plan. Well, 6 o'clock comes, and he hasn't even thought about his room. 7 o'clock comes, and my wife's getting nervous because his room's kind of a disaster. And the closet. So Carol says, honey, don't you think you need to remind him? And I said, no. This is a deal between us. He's going to do it. I just know he is. It's 7:30. I'm getting nervous. So I remind him. I said, Dave, you better start in that room because you can't go to bed till you get the room done. Okay. So he starts working in the room. Now, David's my only child that when he was tired would go to bed. Even when he was in high school, if he was tired, he'd go to bed at 9:30 at night and get up at 4 and study and get his work done. And all the rest of my kids, we never go to bed till the last person's, you know, gone, because we were afraid we'll miss something. I mean, even last night at 1 o'clock, Tom has to take this couple that's here, Rick and Deb, back to where they're staying. And he said, you can go to bed. I'll just run. I said, no, I'll go with you. And I said, I don't want to miss something. And I still had to pack. But David would always tell you when he's tired and just go to bed. Well, at 9:30, he is so tired. Dad, I am really tired. Can I go to bed? I promise I'll finish it in the morning or tomorrow after church. I said, Dave, as soon as you get your room done, you can go to bed. At 11 o'clock, we've got a crying boy. At 12 o'clock, Mom is starting to feel sorry. You know what it's going to be like? This tired boy all day tomorrow at church. Huh, Moms? You all know what we got coming here tomorrow? Disaster. And my wife is saying to me, honey, you know, he really is made a lot of progress. It is so late. I said, honey, as soon as his bedroom's done, he can go to bed. At 1:30, he crawls into bed. The next Saturday night at 10 o'clock, he's almost done. He's dead tired. He says, Dad, I only have about 20 more minutes, half hour to go. I promise when I get home from church tomorrow, even before I eat lunch, I'll finish up my room. Could I go to bed now? Now, how many, when he's done that much progress and took that much initiative the second week, how many would say, hey, give the kid a break? Huh? That's right. I said, Dave, as soon as your room's done, you can go to bed. The next week, he started cleaning his room up Friday night. Had it done Saturday morning. Now, by the way, that never changed. That never changed. All through their teen years, they had 100 reasons why they couldn't get it done. David, his senior year, I don't know if I told you this. I spoke to about 5 times this week to different groups. I don't think I told you this, but David, his senior year, he was president of a senior class. They had to raise money, you know, it's a Christian school, had to raise money for their senior trip. He's playing a major sport. He's taking piano lessons. Now, David is a very good pianist. And we made it a point that all of our children had to take piano lessons till they can at least play out of the hymn book. Because music is how vital to being filled with the Spirit and everything. So it's a part of our life, and so they had to take piano lessons. Now, I had two kids that hated the piano lessons like I did. I took for 6 years, and I hated it. And I'm telling you, when my daughter Cheryl got Jesus Loves Me down, I mean, she's coming with the boat. Listen, Dad, listen to me right now. And it wasn't Jesus Loves Me. She can tell you what it was, Standing on the Promises or something. And boy, as soon as she could nosedive and get out of those lessons, it was over. But David and Karen both were very good. And David, his junior year, when he was president of the class, played for the awards banquet or something like that, and nobody even knew he could play. But just before his senior year, he says, Dad, I got so much to do my senior year that I really need, I want to quit taking lessons. And I said, Dave, it's too great a talent of yours. You're just too good at it. And I want you to finish taking through your senior year. But Dad, and we weren't mad at each other. I said, no, that's the way it's going to be. And he didn't go out and pout and give me a hard time. I said, look, if you got some other reasons, I says, I'm open to it. He says, no, that's it. I says, okay. So 3 months later, I'm walking into the gymnasium and his piano teacher sees me and she says, I'd like to know whether David's going to be, continue taking his piano lessons or if he's going to be serious about this or not. And I said, what do you mean? She said, well, he's already missed 5 lessons so far this fall. Now, what's that? Disobedience, disrespect, or irresponsibility? Irresponsibility. So we had a talk Sunday afternoon, and I said, Dave, now he also was the aide to the principal the last hour, and his piano lessons were during the last hour, he and Karen's. And on 3 of those occasions, he was running an errand. He got out of school earlier in the afternoon and was running an errand for the principal and was gone in the car and honestly forgot it. The other two, he just didn't do it. So I said, now, if this happens again, then you're going to have to stay out of all school activities for a week. Now, he was so busy. There were 2 basketball tournaments coming up. The senior class was in charge of the concession stand. If he wasn't there and getting the kids there, kids didn't come and that type of thing. And he was a very, very busy person. He graduated from high school with a 4.03 average. So he also didn't slough off on his grades. When he went to college, he clept all the way through college calculus. So he's a guy that does a lot of things. And he has that capacity, and so I said, you're going to be out of all school activities. Well, I thought that was such, when you come up with one of these really tough punishments, any smart kid would know better than to cross that one. So I felt pretty good about that. Wednesday, I come into the gym, and Karen's in there, and I said, where's Dave? He's up taking his piano lesson. I just finished mine. I said, oh, that's right. So I'm standing down there for about 10 minutes, and Mrs. Brown comes down. She's a tough teacher. You had to practice every day. She would not take you if you would not make your children practice their half hour at least every day, and the child had to sign it off, and you had to sign it off. You could not accumulate 2.5 hours on Saturday. She comes down, and she says, where is your boy, David? I said, he's not up taking his lesson? She said, no, he never showed up. Just then, I look across the gym, and in the far door comes David. And I said, hey, Dave. And he looks, and by the time he gets over to us, the kid is ashen white. He doesn't even look at me. He looks at her, and he apologizes to her, and he says, I completely forgot. And he was running an errand for the principal, and he just lost track. He honestly did. Now, I wasn't mad at him. when we're driving home, I said, you know, you're going to be home by yourself the rest of this week. He says, I know it. And we're right in the middle of a tournament. And the parents of the seniors have to clean up the gym and everything afterwards. And by the time I'm into this thing on Friday night, I'm saying, that was about the most stupid punishment I ever came up with. I got to do his work and mine too. But you know what? He went home, didn't sulk and pout around. We were involved in painting the barn. He went out and spent the time working and painting the barn, had a great attitude. And Friday night, I say to Carol, I says, honey, this kid has had such a great attitude. He hasn't given us any hassle. He's been responsible. Can you all sense where I'm starting to head toward? And my wife looks up at me and she says, don't you dare. You let him go through this thing. This is good for him. So I said, okay. So I just didn't say anything to him, and he went through that whole thing. Didn't have another problem with it the rest of the year. He just finished, he assumed his responsibilities. Had a mother in Birmingham. Told her, boy, I want you to make your bed before you go to school in the morning. And this is the day after she heard this lecture. Next morning, he gets up, figures a way not to make his bed, heads for school. She gets in the car, goes to school, checks him out of school, brings him home, makes him make his bed, and then sends him back to school. Now, you don't have to worry about doing that, because who's that teenager going to tell? And where'd you go? Oh, I went home, made my bed. You give me a break. Now, you see, where we make the mistake with responsibilities is that we let the next important activity come up and be an excuse for not fulfilling the responsibilities. They've got a job to do, and it's supper time. You can eat as soon as your job's done. David's senior year, he was dating the queen of the school, had a big date going for Saturday night. He's got a whole day's work gone on Saturday. It was going to be one of those busy days. We had so much to get done. And I'm watching him just kind of fritter the morning away. So I waited till just as late as I could, to where he's going to almost have to run all day to get it done now. But I just casually said, I says, hey, Dave, you better call Julie and tell her how late you're going to be for the date tonight. She said, what do you mean? I said, you're going to be late for your date. You got so much to do, and you're not going to get it done before the date. Dad, this is a big date. I said, I know it is, but you're going to be late for it. I'm not mad. My son has a responsibility, and if he's not going to be responsible, the correction to irresponsibility is to get them to be responsible. You don't have to be mad about it. And he says, Dad, I says, Dave, you're going to be late. In fact, if you think it's impossible now, maybe you better change the date. Call her up and set it up for next Saturday night. Guess what? He had it all done and left for the date on time. Now, you don't have to say, I'm not going to tell you again. If they're irresponsible, you have them fulfill the responsibility. Now, if you haven't been doing this, all you need to do is sit down with your kids and say, look, our goal is to make our family better. And we've been handling some things a certain way, and we're going to change that. And I'll tell you what, the kids, when they understand this, you are so predictable that they will turn around and say, uh-oh, Mom, you blew it. I mean, you should have made us do it. They will. And when they understand that they're to obey, which means I'm to do what I'm told when I'm told to do it. Now, your ultimate goal is to do what you're told when you're told with the right attitude. But that doesn't always come in us either. And when they're starting to have the bad attitude, and I don't feel like doing it, Dad, I don't want to do this. Or I don't like doing this. Remember one time Dave needed to clean out the two stalls in the barn. And he's saying, Dad, I don't want to do this. Now, was there anything wrong with him not wanting to do that? Go out there and work in the manure? Huh? Was there anything wrong with him saying, I don't like doing this? You know, a lot of parents actually believe that for the child to be honest and say, I don't like to do something they were told to do, that they're being disrespectful or disobedient. None of that is disrespect. None of that is disobedience. That is their opinion. Or they say, I don't feel like doing this. And I remember that one instance, I said, Dave, I totally understand you not liking to do that. And I totally understand you not wanting to do it. And I totally understand you not feeling like doing it, because I also don't want to do it and don't feel like it. And that's why you are. And you don't have to like it and you don't have to want to. You just have to cooperate. And when you give them that space that they understand, there's nothing wrong with me disagreeing or expressing my opinion. And if you'll listen to a teenager, almost every time they're right. They're right. Where the crossover is that the younger they are, the more difficult it is to express their opinion with the right attitude. So when they express their opinion, and by the way, at age 9 or 10 is when their mind reaches puberty. That's when they actually begin to think just like you think, or I think. Remember that you could think like your parents long before they knew you could? But then you'd try to say it, and it would come out wrong, and they would tell you you were sassing. And then some parents say, don't you go talking like that. Now you shut up. I don't want to hear another word out of you. Now, what I said was right, and the way I said it was wrong. So you have to start teaching your child. Listen for what they're saying. And allow them to say what they're saying, but teach them how to say it the right way. One time, Carol, she was writing up a Christmas letter, and she signed this Christmas letter, Carol, for the Coys. And Cheryl was 9 years old, and she's standing out there in the kitchen. I'm in the living room, and all of a sudden I'm hearing this argument develop between Carol and Cheryl. And it's kind of getting worse and worse, and I'm listening to this thing, and I'm sort of thinking, you know, Carol isn't handling this right. I mean, she just handled this thing right. This thing would be over with. It's so logical to work out. So I walk out there like the big solution, and I say, you know, what seems to be the trouble? I always, you know, get my foot in my mouth like this. And so they start to explain it to me, and Cheryl said, Mom, you signed this letter wrong. You signed it Carol for the Coys, and you should have signed it Carol from the Coys. This is what the big argument was over. And so I knew this one was so simple that I said, Cheryl, now let me just ask you something. If I ask you to do something for me, and then I wanted you to write it down that you did it, you would say, Cheryl did this for Dad. You wouldn't say, Cheryl did this from Dad. Now, wasn't that a logical explanation? Very clear. All of you, vote for me. Right? And I just made that explanation to her, and she said, huh-uh. You know, and I'm starting to react. I said, Cheryl, it should be Carol for the Coys, not from the, huh-uh, it should be from the Coys. And I'm starting to get irked. And she's starting to get tough, you know. She's got those big brown eyes, and she's got the same spiritual gift I have, and so when we lock in, boy, we've locked in. And I'm starting to lean, and she's starting to lean back, and then I stop, I back up, I said, wait a minute. I said, Cheryl, look, there's nothing wrong with you having your opinion, even though I think you're wrong. But you may not talk that way. You understand? And you should see the light bulbs go on. It's like, oh, okay, I can still say it, but I need to say it right. You know, that one lesson didn't change the way she said everything for the rest of her life. The next time it happens, you bring it, look, whoa, 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 wait a minute. I want you to say what you're going to say, but get rid of that attitude first, okay? Just so you and I can talk. And they change it. And they learn to express themselves without being threatened when they're talking to somebody in authority. And so if we'll keep these three things in mind, now all four of my children chose to have a temper tantrum, which is what? Just blatant rebellion. All three of them chose to do that once. Two of them chose to do it in front of people. The other two did it alone. Just absolutely fell apart, defiant. Cheryl chose to do it in a car with company. Carol said she could go with me in the car, and as long as she took a nap, and we're driving down the highway, and I even let her, you know, kind of stay awake for another 30 minutes. And finally, I turned around and I said, Cheryl, I said, it's time for you to, you know, take your nap, and I want you to lay down there, and I want you to go to sleep. And those brown eyes turned into a rage. And she told me no, and she kicked the back of my car seat. Now, anytime it's sheer rebellion, you don't sit down and talk to the child. You don't go through five steps of understanding. And I probably became a little overdramatic. David chose to do his with company in the house. And brother, when he did, we didn't talk. I stood up, I grabbed him by the arm, and I drug him to the bedroom, and I took him in there, and I gave him paddling, and I said, you may not do this again. Do you understand? And he never did it again. With Cheryl, I slammed on the brakes on the expressway, pulled over to the side. This poor person with me is probably, you know, what in the world is happening? Yanked her out of the back of that car, took her to the back of the car, and paddled her. And I said, you may not do that again. Do you understand? And she said she understood and never happened. And had it happened the next time, boy, it had been more dramatic. Rebellion is bound up in the heart of a child, and a rod of correction will drive it far from him. Rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry. And brother, when that happens, you're to jump on that one like a hot potato and deal with that. And I'll tell you what, you deal with it quickly, and you'll be amazed at how far you drive that option out of the child's life. Now, when they're younger, when the child is about 5 months old, we'll back up a little bit to, you know, what can we do here between this, you know, when they're just starting out until they're about two or three. When the child is about 5 months old, that's when they start becoming a little bit more mobile. That's when our kids were in a little walker. They start, now all of a sudden they can get to territory that they've never been to before. And the first thing you want to teach your child is the meaning of the word no. Now there's nothing sinful with what they're about to touch. There's nothing sinful in grabbing for the television. But you have to decide as a parent what you want your child to do in your home and what you don't want them to do. And you have to keep one major thing in mind. I'm raising my child to leave home. So what I dictate as a behavior in my home is what I expect my child to do when we visit somebody else's home. And so, when I do that with my child, and my child starts to reach for something, I want my child to cease what they're doing. See, you wouldn't have any problem with that if you knew the stove was hot and the baby is going over for the stove and goes to reach, see? Because that's the more extreme thing where I have the baby's best interest at heart. Or you have another child, like we did, the 6 or 7 year old, who's cutting out things and leaves the scissors inadvertently on the floor, and the baby's going for the scissors, and you know what the baby will do with shiny scissors. You don't want them doing that. How are you going to stop them? You can't get from here to there before they do it. So the purpose of teaching the child the meaning of the word no is to get the child to respect what you're saying and just to stop what they're doing. Now, with my oldest daughter, Sharon, it took us one day It was amazing to me. She goes and she reaches for something, and Carol would say, "No, Sharon." And she'd go to reach for something, "No, Sharon." And she would stop it, and we could go into another person's home. Now, everything in another person's home is totally new. What does every child go after? Every shiny object, everything that interests them. Now, if you don't know how to control your child, your friends would love to have you over as long as you leave your brat at home. And so you go to someone else's house and you watch your child, and Sharon would go over to pick up this little crystal thing on the table, and I would say, "Sharon," she'd look back, I'd say, "No." And she'd just put her hands down and go somewhere else. We kept someone's child who they had just adopted. And you know, when you're adopting and the child's like 5 or 6 months old and you're wondering, you know, how much is psychologically is this going to affect them? And, you know, you go through all those things. And so we keep this little girl. And I mean, she's in our house. They just leave for 2 weeks. They're going down to Canada for a mission to be missionaries. First thing she does, she goes right over to our philodendron plant and grabs it and pulls it over. We got dirt all over the carpeting. She goes over to the television. And so we just went over to her, and I says, "Honey, we're going to treat her just like our own." She goes to her, "Susie, no." Took us 2 days. And that little girl, you could sit anywhere, you say, "Susie, no." They just drop their hands. And I thought, you know, if this is all there is to raising kids, honey, let's have a dozen. This is so unbelievable. And then Cheryl came along. It took us 9 months to get that one thing across to her. She would reach for that, "Cheryl, no." She'd reach again, "Cheryl, no." She'd reach again, "Cheryl, no." She'd reach again, "Cheryl, no." You know, and then she'd look up at you as if to say, "No, I don't know what your hang up is," and go waddling off. Now, Cheryl is our most creative child. And you know what? She's our most submissive. You see, people say, "Oh, you don't want to, you're liable to destroy the child's creativity." That's a bunch of baloney. The rebellion is in that will. The creativity is in a child's spirit. You let the rebellion go on, and you'll never see all the potential and creativity in that child. I know that that little lesson saved David's life once. Carol came to pick me up at a seminar, hot August day, and she says, "Honey, I need to go to the washroom. Would you just watch David for a minute?" And I said, "Sure." Here's this little kid in diapers. And I'm standing here, and I thought I had a hold of him. And I'm talking to somebody, and I just forget about him. And I just turn and I look, and David had run out through the double doors of this building, crossed the sidewalk, was going between two cars out into a four-lane highway. And he's running out, and I turn, and I said, "David, no!" And he's running just like this, and he goes right up on his tiptoes and stops. He turns around and looks at me. And so I said, come on back and see Daddy. And he comes waddling back in. And I picked him up and hugged him. Now, so that's our first goal, teaching the meaning of the word no. Then the next goal is to break the child's will without breaking his spirit, so that when the child chooses, you know, to do things wrong, then the child needs to be corrected. And God has provided two little spongy spots back there. I'm convinced a spanking properly administered is never remembered by a child prior to 4 years of age. Now, if you hit the child in the face or the legs or the arms or they were unfairly punished, they remember it. But when they were wrong, and you give them that old swat in the back. Have you ever noticed how children's attitudes keep deteriorating? And you know a confrontation's coming. You even try to, maybe if I'm nicer, and you try to cook their meal a little better, and you try to be more patient, it just seems to be counterproductive. They just get worse anyway. Do you know why that is? Because our children are doing things wrong. Maybe they were playing with each other and shoved the other one. Now, nobody else was around. Nobody knows it. The other one didn't cry. They got the crayons, and they found out that nobody can see it in the closet behind the clothes, and they're making pictures on the closet wall like my children did? So what happens? It starts accumulating guilt. Guilt affects what? My attitude. And doesn't it amaze you that when you finally catch them doing something wrong and you spank them, it is like you have a brand new child. You do not know what, and you know what you did? You cleansed the child's conscience. Punishment that hurts chases evil from the heart.